The act of designing is full of decisions. Usually, when you want to decide on something, you need to have options. A life without options is for a designer like a beach without an ocean. Before you can make a decision between options, you'll have to evaluate those options to determine their value. Of course, this value is related to criteria, objectives, or design goals. And designers need to make decisions all along the design process, such as deciding what problem to tackle, deciding what concept to continue with, or about executing a user test. So in principle, evaluating your ideas for reducing stress in a user morning ritual and choosing the best does not differ from any other situation where the designer has to decide. The decision itself is making a choice. Unlike many other types of decisions, design decisions have to do with many criteria. It doesn't matter how simple your product is, there are always requirements that relate to the product's functioning, the use, the production, the environmental impact, aesthetics, impact on society, pricing, construction, and so on. So you have many criteria. Some of the decision-making methods are used in situations with much uncertainty. For such methods, the consequences of a chosen option also depends on less controllable circumstances or other stakeholders that decide too. In this lecture, we will exclude these methods and focus on methods where consequences of a chosen option depends on the alternatives only. So design decisions in my lecture can only be made under certainty. A third condition for design decisions is that we assume one decision maker only, or a group of individuals with the same goal. Nevertheless, decision makers with different goals exist, but for them, other methods need to be used. Evaluating alternatives by giving them a value is not the only aspect that makes a decision. Decisions are also influenced by the willingness of the decision maker to take risk and by his or her use of intuition. A director and a designer of a company might invest $100,000 in the production of a new product because marketing predicted high sales volume. But they will not know for sure that this will happen. They might even be opposed by others with different goals because one of the earlier innovations flopped. In the decision-making process, the designer might trust his intuition to influence the decision as well, particularly when he has relevant experience with making similar decisions in the past. I trust it's clear now that giving a value to something is often subjective. Both intuition and risk are involved. There's no such thing as the one and only right decision in design. So let's take a look at a typical design situation. Assume a problem is defined which has to do with improving people's painting experience when painting their own house, interior or exterior. The current situation starts with immersing a brush in an opened can of paint and dragging the bristles across the lip. Some paints get into the rim, and soon the paint drips over the edge. The user's hands, the tabletop, and the floor are soon splattered with paint. Especially when the brush is placed on top of the can from time to time. This will result in a frustration and perhaps a feeling of incompetence. Why can't I paint without making a mess? This problem has been tackled many times, and the designer, in our example, comes up with three different solutions in the form of concepts. Each of these has their own pros and cons, and the designer wants to evaluate these alternatives and choose one of them for further elaboration. Of course, there is a set of criteria captured in a list of requirements, so let's put them in a table together with the three alternatives. It is easy to imagine that this representation will not help us to get a quick answer on what is the best solution. You would have to be able to process 7 criteria for 3 alternatives equals 21 combinations. But this is not the only complication. We have to make sure that there is no dominant solution, a solution that outperforms the others on each objective. If this would be the case, the decision is easy and you would not need this lecture. The second is that usually there are various properties which are not equally important. For example, cleaning might be considered more important than aesthetics, or the other way around. Thirdly, the skills for different criteria on which you assess each alternative are different. for example, seconds, dollars, or months. And in the fourth place, you have to deal with both qualitative and quantitative criteria. For example, dollars versus dough. The intriguing problem now is, how can we, for each alternative, add up all values for one alternative to one value only, to compare with the other values of other other alternatives? For this, we have a number of methods, of which I will explain one in my next lecture. Thank you for listening.